going to say right now, people skip the hymn after the sermon, and we'll just go right into the offering. So that will save us a little bit of sitting in the heat. I just wanted to look at the Colossians passage really quickly. It's kind of like eating your broccoli so you can get your dessert. So if we were looking for a little light reading, Colossians probably is a little too dry and academic for a light reading. But we have to think about that reading in the context of empire. We have to think about it in the context of living in a land, like the first churches were, where the government is hunting you down. And so when we think of these words to the church in Colossus, it takes on another flavor. Because Christians are the minority group. They live under the rule of Caesar. And so the message to this small church, to all the minority Christians, is do not fear that the emperor or be coerced into pledging your allegiance to Caesar. Jesus is the one to emulate, to follow, to listen to. The church is the body of Christ, and Jesus is the head. And so you have an alternative to living under the thumb of Caesar, and you find freedom in your mind and in your heart living in Christ. So we keep this in mind as we consider the gospel lesson. Did you know that you can tell a lot about a person by the way they eat? My grandmother was telling me a story the other day about her two granddaughters and how different they look. One girl would look at her dinner plate almost as if she was gearing up for battle, and then the first food she would attack would be the one she liked the least. And in this case, it was peas. But her sister, on the other hand, ignored those dreaded peas. She ate a round of those peas, she ate her gravy and her mashed potatoes and her chicken, and in the end, she still had faced those peas. She would stare at them like they were ants or cockroaches. Cockroaches might have been preferable because at least she'd get away with not having to eat them. And so it would take on bargaining and coaxing and eventually mother mashing the peas into some leftover gravy, and maybe she would gag down two or three peas. And she'd actually get to leave some on the plate. So I wonder, which one had a better strategy? Picture Martha and Mary growing up just like this. Just like that at the dinner table. Olives again. Martha would dutifully eat her olives first, and Mary would let them sit, trying to camouflage them. And then she would draw a sigh from her mother, who would relent and let her get away with eating one or two olives, and then having dessert. So our gospel lesson shows these two girls as grown-ups. There's all grown up, but they're still very like their girlish selves. Martha invited Jesus to come into the house, and she was doing all the good things a host would do in that day. But Mary, on the other hand, was pretty much breaking the rules. Now, if Mary had instead been Michael, a man, it would be quite normal for him to be sitting at the rabbi's feet listening to the teachings and learn. But Mary is breaking the rules. Probably not the first one. So why don't you send Mary home with me, Jesus? Martha says. And Jesus' response to Martha could be read instead of as a rebuke, but really as a gentle correction rather than something harsh. Martha, 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 you're worried. You're distracted by many things. There is need of only one thing. And that one thing for Martha is to receive the gracious presence of Jesus, to listen to his words, to know that she is valued not for what she does or how well she does it, but that she is valued because she is a child of God. So in the end, the gospel lesson is not about women's roles in society. Instead, it's about priorities. It's about timing. It's about the circumstances in which which we find ourselves and contexts that need to call us to act a little bit more differently. And that means listening to Jesus' call to his followers. Jesus called us. Jesus called that then and now. It's not always obvious when we read the Bible that Jesus feels an urgency about his message and his ministry. But he does feel that urgency. He's trying to reach as many people as possible. And it's just as urgent today as it was back then. And so Jesus is calling us through these lessons this morning to just pay attention. Pay attention to where God is at work in the world. So sometimes that means we have to set aside the ordinary and sometimes very important tasks that we're focused on to open up our eyes to where God is working, calling us to be working, or where God is at work around us. So we can be both like Martha and Mary, but ultimately we all need to hear and know that each one of us is valued for who we are as children of God. That's a piece of the message that Jesus brought. And when we can feel that, when we can know deep in our souls that we are God's children, then we can be about our work and we find joy in it, and that joy spills over to how we relate to one another and to the strangers, so that we can be like Martha and offer the hospitality, but also sit and listen, so that in some way we bring Jesus' presence to another in this world that so needs it, especially so needed in this empire, in this time. As the children of PBS learned, God is good, life is good, and God is good.